In this R tutorial, I'm going to show you how to use the incredibly useful plyr map values function. So over here, I have a new project with some data that we can load up. So the first thing I'm going to do is come over to here and I'm going to type in library tidyverse, control enter, and I'm going to load up our data set. So dt read CSV, open brackets, and I have a folder over here called data. And in it, I have this CSV file, top10departments.csv. Control enter to load that in. And let's just take a quick look at what this data set looks like. So over here, let me make this a bit bigger. I have 10 different departments. Now, a common thing that you'd want to do is maybe you'd want to create some sort of mapping table to change some of these values to maybe either nicer, shorter names, or maybe group some of them together. And this is what plyr map values will help us to do very effectively. I'm just going to open up this in Excel and create a little mapping table. So over here, I have department and I have account over here. Let's, before we do any additional work with this, let's do a file save as. Okay, and instead let's call this mapping table and hit enter. So on this side, I'm going to change these column headings from department. I'm just going to change this to map from and map to. Let's just say that this name over here, we just think it's too long. So let's give it a shortened name. Depth of health and / human services, SRVS. So that could be an alternate name that we can use for this value here. We want to group all of these into finance. Control enter to do all of those. Over here, let's just say for argument's sake that we want to group all of these into, say, the technology department or something like that. Control enter, assign all of those. And for these values here, what I'm going to actually do is I'm just going to delete these. So I'm just going to delete these entire rows and click OK. Now, the reason I'm doing this for this example is to show what happens when you don't have all of the values in the mapping table. Because even if you do have all the mapping values at that point in time, what can often happen is, let's say you have a field like department. When your data set gets new departments, then your mapping table could become out of date. And we'll talk a little bit more about this as we get into this example. But for now, let me save this and close this down. I'm going to come back over to R and I'm going to load this into an object called mapping table, read CSV, data mapping table.csv. Tab to autocomplete that for me, control enter to assign it. So now if I look at this here, mapping table, so here we can see the map from values, there's the map to values over here. We can't quite see that. So if you wanted to, we also have mapping table down here where I can click the view button to view that as a table. And there we have our mapping. So let me come back to our script over here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a mutate function, which comes from tidyverse. So mutate basically allows us to alter or add new columns. I'm going to alter the column named called department. So we have a column name in here already called department. And right now, it's basically all of these values over here. What we want to do is we want to map those values to our mapping table. Now, let's just pause for a second here. There are several ways you can potentially do this. One potential way is using something like an if-else statement. Now, I've seen plenty of times where people have used really, really big if statements with lots and lots of nested if statements to do these kind of mappings. Now, the problem with that is that if you have very, very big lists, you can end up with really, really horribly long if statements, which are really difficult to maintain. Now, the better and other common way that people solve for this is they will do something like a join. So now the problem with the join is that whenever a value is not present in that mapping table, it will create an NA value, which you then have to write some additional logic for to basically fill in the gaps. So this is where the plyr map values function comes in incredibly useful, because it's kind of like a join, but it has a few benefits. One, you don't necessarily need to create a new column, right? Because sometimes you just want to update this column that we have here without having to create another column, which you would get if you had a join. And secondly, plyr map values automatically deals with what would otherwise be NA values in a join. Instead of taking the NA values, it'll just take the value which is already in that field and say, well, I don't have a mapping value for it, so let's just use the original value, which is often the behavior that you would want to implement with additional code anyway, all done for you within a single function. So let's go ahead and write plyr :: map values. Now, you may not be familiar with this syntax that I've just used here. By typing this in here, plyr is actually the library name. Now, often we load our libraries at the beginning of the script, like we have here with the Tidyverse library. And these :: shows us that that is the library in front of this function. Often it can be useful to type this in, even if you're just like looking, you know that you're looking for a function inside a particular library and you want to get access to all of those particular functions. This can be a nice shortcut to find out what those are. But the reason why I'm using plyr in particular here, as opposed to loading it as a library here, is that Tidyverse is actually a collection of libraries, most notably including dplyr. dplyr is what allows us to use functions like mutate and these pipe functions here. Plyr is actually sort of, in a way, like an older version of dplyr. So because of that, a lot of the functions overlap. And if you load both libraries up, what happens is that sometimes you can end up overriding some of the newer functions with older functions which have the same name. Now, to avoid that, there's two ways that you can basically do this. One, you can load the plyr library before I load the Tidyverse library. And secondly, you can just call the library like this so that none of its other functions will accidentally override the other libraries that you're using. Because for the most part of it, mapvalues is the only function that I'm still really using from the plyr library, I find it very useful just to access it this way, as you can see here. Now, coming back to the map values function, what this takes is first of all, it's going to take the column that I want to change. So in this case, I can again type in department. And then you can see here that it's got a few additional attributes. I've got a from attribute, a to attribute, and this kind of warn missing. So now the key ones here is from and to, so let me just stick those in. So from equals, and our mapping table $map from. So now, if you're not familiar with the syntax here, if I type in a name of a data frame slash table, column name, and enter that, it returns me a vector of all of these values here, right? So that's what's being entered into here. Let me add a comma. And here I'm going to type in two equals. And then I'm going to do the next one. So mapping table, $map2, right? So if I just run that there, like so, we can see that this has now changed for us. So here we've got our rename. Here we've got our grouping. And down the bottom here, we basically have the values that we didn't supply any mapping for. So there you have it, an incredibly powerful, incredibly useful function. If you found this video helpful, please remember to give a thumbs up. If you're not subscribed yet and you want to learn tips, tricks, and tools to help you and your team work more effectively with data, hit the subscribe button and the notification icon so you don't miss anything. Thanks for watching this video, and I'll see you next time.